Assalamu alaikum and good morning, everyone. It's a pleasure to speak to you all at the occasion of this second Artificial Intelligence Summit taking place in Karachi. My name is Yasir Ayaz, and I work as a professor of Artificial Intelligence and Robotics at NUST in Islamabad. I am also heading the National Center of Artificial Intelligence as its chairman and central project director. So today I'll be speaking a little bit about what sort of activities we are doing at the National Center of Artificial Intelligence, basically who we are, what we are, and what sort of projects we do. So a little bit about myself to start with. I'm a professor of Artificial Intelligence and Robotics at NUST in Islamabad. Prior to that, I've done my PhD in robot intelligence from Japan, from Tohoku University there. I'm also still a specially appointed professor at Tohoku University in Japan. And in addition to all of this role, I am also the chairman and central project director for the National Center of Artificial Intelligence of Pakistan. As we continue in the presentation, I'll be speaking more about what sort of organization this National Center for Artificial Intelligence is, where we are based, and what sort of projects we're doing. Other than that, I have a number of other contributions, like I founded the IEEE Robotics and Automation Society in Pakistan, which has chapters in Islamabad, Lahore, Karachi, and pretty much everywhere where IEEE has any presence in Pakistan. And also, I've been able to author a few publications, which have been cited by almost like MIT, Carnegie Mellon, Georgia Tech, all the big names that you can take. So, alhamdulillah, I've been lucky in that even my research in Pakistan has been cited well by top universities. I have a few patents in my name as well, and I've been lucky to be able to win the overall highest award of NUST, which is the overall best teacher award, given to only one faculty member each year. And it was conferred to me by the President of Pakistan. So without further ado, let me continue with this presentation. I have a few more pictures of myself to give you a further idea about what sort of background work I have done. So this is me during my PhD days. I worked on humanoid robots, and my work during my PhD was to recognize obstacles, to pass through them, to make paths and find out paths, and actually with a real humanoid robot to actually navigate through a living human environment. Also, like I've done a number of other projects since my return to Pakistan, and this includes intelligent wheelchair project, a RoboCup on the left that you can see. This is very well familiar with everyone. It's the first team ever, the first and the only team ever from South Asia that made it to the topmost league of the International RoboCup competition. We have several projects in prosthetics, bionics, rehabilitation domain. So basically, operating machines in the real human environments is the theme behind most of these projects. And also, like, we've been able to, like, bring artificial intelligence into all of these systems, because you see, like, in many things, like, artificial intelligence is actually the solution. Because, for example, when it comes to prosthetics, for example, or just driving a wheelchair, for example, so many people are so severely disabled that they can't really steer it on their own. Similarly, you have to put, like, better safety mechanisms, that the wheelchair should be able to stop itself when, for example, it's faced by some danger. And for example, if you're driving it using your brain, like this wheelchair can be driven using the human brain. So if you want to do that, you see here this, in this picture, the person is wearing a brain headset. So if you give a command, for example, to turn right, what does turn right actually mean? Is it 30 degrees right? Is it 40 degrees right? So a lot of these things, all of them have underlying technology of artificial intelligence, and the image processing, the machine vision recognition, and the path planning, etc., all fall under this domain. So broadly, there are like perception, cognition, and action domains when it comes to artificial intelligence and robotics. And now I head the National Center of Artificial Intelligence in Pakistan. I've been featured on a number of television programs as well. I just put a couple of pictures here. Perhaps you might have seen me. I used to have a beard back then. I don't know if you remember or not, if you might have seen on a television program. So now I'm heading the National Center of Artificial Intelligence, which has branches in Islamabad, Peshawar, Lahore, and Karachi as well. So it's like the good thing about the National Center of Artificial Intelligence is that this was formed by Higher Education Commission of Pakistan on competitive grounds, that they invited applications from all the universities of Pakistan, and the best of the best professors from every university submitted their proposals. I was also submitting the proposal competing from NUST side, and after competitive evaluation, they selected the best universities in which to place the labs of artificial intelligence specialization. So each one of the professors in this particular artificial intelligence setup has a proven track record of strong projects, artificial intelligence projects, both in theory, both in research, as well as in the practical terms. So as we go forward, you'll see each one of the labs and the names will be flashed in front of you, and perhaps you will recognize a few of them. Starting with the first foremost thing that like artificial intelligence, many people think these days that because the word is so familiar and so widespread, so probably everybody knows what artificial intelligence is. But if you ask people to precisely define artificial intelligence, you'll see a lot of different definitions coming from different people, right? So there are four different kinds of definitions that actually come there. I didn't put all four here, but this is more like a rather universally accepted definition of artificial intelligence that I put in the first bullet. The method by which human systems are able to perform tasks that normally require human intelligence, such as visual perception, speech recognition, decision making, and translation between languages. So you see, it covers all these three domains: perception, cognition, and action. So all three of these domains are the domains of artificial intelligence. Artificial intelligence is already everywhere. We see it around us. Like just a few days ago, I bought a very nice automatic washing machine for home. And when I brought it and we placed it at home, took off the covers and everything, I saw that there was a label of AIDD, AI Direct Drive on top of it. So you see, the artificial intelligence era has like formally begun as the era of Industry 4.0. The Industry 4.0 is actually the era of artificial intelligence. It's post-2015 era. But AI in itself as a field was not invented in this century. It is an invention of the last century. It was being used for machine translation, automatic translation during the Second World War as well. But recent advancements in computing and also other the systems, that, you know, the computing systems have become advanced enough to actually enable artificial intelligence to become more commonplace and to get into real systems. And for us to, and we've been able to like generate things like big data, right? So with that big data, data analytics, and this has put artificial intelligence into, you know, like the algorithms into much more, you could say, in a term that, you know, it becomes useful for everyone. That they can do to data analytics, get useful information, which is not otherwise possible for them to make without formally analyzing that sort of data. But the applications of AI, the field of AI, and the way it is applied is far beyond just data analytics. And there's a lot of things like the ones I've mentioned, like visual perception, speech recognition, decision making, translation between languages, etc. There are a number of other applications. So the field is spreading, and AI is already everywhere as well. The technology is widely used in ways that are obvious, like self-driving car. When you see a self-driving car, you see an obvious application of artificial intelligence. But other ways that are inconspicuous are also there. For instance, we are doing a project with the Judiciary of Pakistan in which we are helping to bring up the relevant cases, that whenever a new case is submitted to a certain court, so that court, while making decisions, should be able to refer to all the similar cases that were submitted in the past and what sort of decision making has been done on those cases. So this kind of applications don't make it very obvious that behind this thing is artificial intelligence, but nearly every step in this whole procedure is AI. For example, start with digitization. So, like, yeah, you know, digitization, everybody accepts that Pakistan needs digitization. Some people think that we don't need AI yet. So, but digitization is possible through AI, basically. The OCR, the simple optical character recognition that you do, is actually artificial intelligence. Putting data into a form where a large chunk of data is organized and you can pick out relevant data and find it out in, you know, reasonable time, involves search algorithms. First of all, it involves knowledge representation. Then it involves data mining and search algorithms. All three of these are also artificial intelligence. So there are ways in which artificial intelligence is like very obvious, other ways in which it's very inconspicuous. If you've been using Google Maps, for example, to travel anywhere recently, voila, you've been using artificial intelligence in your daily life. So AI is forecasted to add $15.7 trillion to the global GDP by the year 2030. The main reason is that this technology is general purpose, having applications that span industries like healthcare, transportation, financial services, energy, and so on. Some consider AI to be on par with what we saw with the revolution of electricity during the 20th century. So this statement is that I've read just now is from Forbes, one of their articles in January 2019. And you see that what they're predicting is that just like in today's era, nothing works without electricity. So in the future that we are headed to, nothing will work without artificial intelligence. Not your mobile phone, not your wristwatch, nothing else. Every single gadget that you see around you has some sort of integration into artificial intelligence, broadly speaking. There might be a few that will take time to integrate artificial intelligence applications, but AI is a field that is destined to become a part of every kind of technology that you are aware of. So if you look at specific areas that are going to be affected, what was predicted was that, for example, marketing and sales and manufacturing and supply chain will have huge impact in the year 2020. I think the real impact, because this was a prediction, the real impact must have been more than this 2.6 trillion in marketing and sales and up to 2 trillion in manufacturing and supply chain, because this COVID-19 has put us into the digital age, right? So we've been forced to enter the digital age before we were actually prepared to. Like, if you had talked to universities maybe 2 years before from now and asked them, can you do virtual education? A lot of people may have had different answers, but now we are doing virtual education and we are also doing these virtual conferences and we all seem to be satisfied. And we have developed tools for it, and like to be able to do it nicely, a lot of digitization has been encouraged, which has further enhanced the role of targeted marketing, targeted sales, which is actually only possible through artificial intelligence. So Gartner predicts that the business value created by artificial intelligence will reach about 3.9 trillion by the year 2022. And the International Data Corporation predicts that the worldwide spending on cognitive and artificial intelligence systems will reach 77.6 billion, in the year 2022. So you see that a lot of countries are investing huge amounts of money into artificial intelligence. Like China is putting $150 billion. They've already pledged to put $150 billion into artificial intelligence. In the US, only the banking sector is putting $300 billion. In Canada, $130 million. India, just next door to us, is putting $477 million into artificial intelligence. The Russia National Strategy for Development of Artificial Intelligence is $7.3 billion. You've already heard Vladimir Putin say that any country who can master AI will actually dominate the world. So this is you know what the race is about these days. And the UK government has also said that they would like to put $1 billion, that they're putting $1 billion into artificial intelligence to compete with the AI superpowers. So if you see the startups, you know, like spawning in artificial intelligence, they are almost everywhere in the world. You don't see a lot in Pakistan here, but many of our startups register abroad, for example, in the US. So the chunk reflected in the US here is not all physically present in the US. A lot of them may have been, you know, located in areas like ours. So in publications, China, US, Japan, United Kingdom, you see all of them there. And like all of them are like developing stuff related to AI. In Pakistan, there's a huge scope of artificial intelligence with a really big population. I've put a conservative estimate of 201 million. So I think the more modern estimates say more than this. And the digitization of data is happening really rapidly in both industry, government, and public. Industry is moving towards the industry 4.0. Like 3.0 has been, I think, embraced. And now people are bringing a lot of automation and robotics. So not all industry, but a lot of industry has started bringing in robots. And like the use of artificial intelligence has been realized even more. Some industries which were not using robots and automation for their manufacturing have started using artificial intelligence-based tools, for example, to check if there is a certain mark on the cloth or something. So even the simple like vision-based quality checking or analysis requires artificial intelligence. So many industries have entered into that era before they would actually bring themselves to the level of automation which Industry 3.0 demands. So number of agencies in Pakistan like HEC, like the Ignite ICT R&D Fund, have already been working with artificial intelligence and they've already been sponsoring AI projects. And recently you see like Punjab Information Technology Board and many other organizations are known to, you know, like work on artificial intelligence projects. The major initiatives include President's Initiative for Artificial Intelligence and Computing and the National Initiative on Artificial Intelligence and Information Security. The second one is led by Governor Punjab. So both of these are basically training initiatives where they train AI manpower, right? The programmers, the people who can earn with AI, train manpower. But when it comes to R&D organizations, organizations that can actually develop AI, I'd say the most, like the initiative known to me, the main initiative is the National Center of Artificial Intelligence, which we will speak about in the rest of the presentation. So the National Center of AI, as I had mentioned to you initially, comprises labs located in different locations in Pakistan. So these were the six universities that were selected by Higher Education Commission on competitive grounds to place the labs of National Center of Artificial Intelligence. These include NUST in Islamabad, OMSATS University Islamabad, NED UET in Karachi, UET Peshawar, UET Lahore, and Punjab University Lahore. So you see, it has presence in Islamabad, Lahore, Peshawar, and Karachi. I'll also show you the map in the next slide again. And the NCI Secretariat looks after all of these labs, and actually it is the central command which actually integrates the laboratories and like helps them in joint work and reaching out to the industry, etc. So I was initially leading the bid from the NUST side, but now I've been asked to actually lead the National Center of Artificial Intelligence, and I'm helping set up the whole National Center and to coordinate the work between all of the setups located in different places. We are overseen by a National Steering Committee, which comprises senior experts from both private and public sector, and also the prominent like the position holders in Planning Commission, Higher Education Commission, and PASHA, etc. And we are also advised by the steering, the National Steering Committee is advised by the Scientific Industrial Advisory Board, which is international. So we've got the international oversight as well. This is how we ensure practicality, and you could say, there are many organizations and many like industries out there that do some sort of AI projects. But the reasons why we stand out, number one, is that this is the team selected on competitive grounds by HEC, and every one of the researchers has some sort of background in product development, in research, and some sort of output that they produce. So they have qualified among the professors of Pakistan to get to this level, right? It was a competitive evaluation. So this is a team that delivers. And number two, that this is a nationwide team. It spreads all across Pakistan. And we are overseen by these top bodies of experts, both national and international, which keep a check on our activities and please keep guiding us again and again. So this is the spread that we are located in Islamabad, Peshawar, Lahore, and Karachi. So the center is located in a lot of these places. I will not read the names of labs from here because we'll cover them one by one in the slides. So I will, to be quick, because I understand that there's positive time. In the deep learning lab at NUST Islamabad deals with the domains of ground surveillance, aerial surveillance, and data surveillance. I think ground and aerial surveillance are camera-based surveillance. In ground, the camera is stationary. In aerial surveillance, the camera is on a plane or a quadcopter or another flying device, which means the camera itself is moving. The background will be changing in the picture while you're applying the artificial intelligence algorithm. So when it comes to data surveillance, this includes, for example, natural language processing to understand, you know, what is being said. So the number of projects in this domain that our labs have done, and these include the project, for example, for judiciary that is being undertaken right now. So there are other projects as well for call centers, for private companies, and also for other organizations for understanding speech and picking out, related words, for example, for a call center, and producing a summary of what's being talked about, for example, during a day. These kind of projects are being done by the deep learning lab. The intelligent robotics lab works in the areas of precision agriculture and also autonomy and mobility, right? So it has a lot of applications like border, metropolis, and neighborhoods management, traffic management for situational awareness, security surveillance, crowd analytics and management during the political rallies and sporting events, etc. The inspection, monitoring, and fault detection in solar farms and oil and gas pipelines, in the crops, in the fields, autonomous inventory management for warehouses, and precision agriculture. So there are a number of applications. Then there is this is in Karachi, the Smart City Lab at NEDUET Karachi. So it has applications in the smart traffic management and control, several applications like number plate detection, vehicle classification, accident reporting app, and also for mobile augmented vision and virtual reality for smart cities. They've done a number of projects. So they develop virtual tours. They've developed one for NED Karachi, but they develop other virtual tours as well. Virtual reality of car engine, augmented reality, for teaching applications like car engine, for example, so visual positioning systems, face detection and app, it's path finder, time masjid finder, etc. So a lot of applications they're developing. Neurocomputation lab at NEDUET Karachi also, this deals with neuromorphic hardware design. You see that AI, like specific domain of AI, is evolving into such a big field that now many organizations are developing hardware which are specific to artificial intelligence or which would work more efficiently with artificial intelligence algorithms. So neuromorphic hardware is one of those types of hardwares which is biologically inspired hardware of on which the algorithms are supposed to run. So neuromorphic hardware development is there, and also the chip design, and the neurofeedback is for more immersive experience. For example, you could imagine that if you're playing a game in virtual or augmented reality, so if you are able to give command using your brain, it would be more immersive and you would feel more realistic about that experience instead of controlling everything with joysticks and other, you know, interfaces which are not natural to you, right? The Intelligent Information Processing Lab deals with the area of mining. So this is mineral resource estimation and mine planning. So to dig safe mines and to be able to do the right mineral resource estimation as well. And the other area covered by this lab is AI in healthcare. So you see that in healthcare, there is a separate tab on medical imaging and diagnostics, but in healthcare, there are a lot more applications in artificial intelligence, even just to know, for example, what sort of disease is spreading in what way, or what sort of medicines will be required at a certain time, require a lot of artificial intelligence based applications. So these two areas are being covered by the Intelligent Information Processing Lab at UT Peshawar. And there is the Intelligent System Design Lab at UT Peshawar, which covers natural disasters like floods, like artificial intelligence to predict and tackle natural disasters like floods, landslides, earthquakes, etc., and man-made disasters like terrorist attacks, other malicious activities, accidents, etc. And while there are no accidents or while there's no natural disaster, for example, since the lab has capability to monitor the environment, so this is what they'll be doing in the normal time, right? So disaster handling is one thing, but for handling the disasters and to be able to predict those disasters, they have to monitor the environment all the time. Medical Imaging and Diagnostics Lab at Komsec University, Islamabad, deals with applications of artificial intelligence for diagnosis of diseases in medical images, right? So like X-rays, CT scans, MRIs, they've developed an application to actually assess whether a certain pneumonia patient has COVID-19 or not. Recently, they were placed at third position at a competition organized by iFlytek Industries in China, and they were third in the world there. And this was regarding the accurate detection of brain tumors and to predict the life expectancy of the patient. So brain tumor detection, breast cancer detection, lung disease detection, especially TB, these are the focus areas of this lab. Intelligent Criminology Lab at UT Lahore deals with crime detection, crime prevention, crime mitigation. So you see, starting from detection of a simple firearm inside a picture or inside the footage of a video camera, to activity recognition, like for example, if someone is pointing a gun at someone, or let's say there's no gun involved, but someone is physically, grabbing someone or trying to kidnap him, this kind of activity recognition is actually done by this lab. So they have very advanced activity recognition capabilities, actually, and the systems that they've developed. So crowd analytics, social media analytics are also there for crime prevention and to predict if some tendency of a crime is developing, and also crime mitigation like forensic animations and, of course, professional trainings. The Agent-Based Computational Modeling Lab at Punjab University in Lahore deals with realistic driving simulators, traffic simulators for design and analysis of interventions in transportation systems. If at any time, for example, you have to close the road at one place, so what will this do to the rest of the traffic? So in lab, so this is not the only application, this is one of the applications, but any application which has an agent-based computational modeling architecture will be falling under the domain of this laboratory. So this is one example of realistic traffic simulator. You could do a lot of other simulators which have multiple agents which need to have separate behavior of their own and to see how the environment will evolve based on that. In lab, driving training assessment, for example, very important area because to thoroughly test a driver, most of the tests that we have, the conventional set tests are not enough. You can't create enough situations in a test to be able to, for example, test a driver in severe conditions. And for example, if you have to give a truck to someone and he has to drive all the way from Karachi to somewhere in the north of Pakistan or to China, so this requires very good driving capabilities which need to be tested in several ways. So this kind of driver assessment has to be done. And in-vehicle driver assistance and support. So for example, if you look at the bottom right, you see that the lady is about to fall asleep while driving. So to detect, for example, drowsiness when a person is driving really long route, so this is very important to prevent accidents. So this kind of applications are being done by this laboratory at Punjab University. So this is just a glimpse of the kind of labs that we have and the kind of projects that the labs are doing. So again, it's a great pleasure to speak to you all, and it's a real privilege, be able to. I wish that we could have interacted physically, but at least a digital encounter, a digital discussion, a digital interaction was possible. you may find me on Facebook, dr.yasser.ayaz, dr.yasser.ayaz, if you can see on the bottom left. This is my handle on Facebook as well as Instagram. If you would like to get in touch with me, you can add me there. And please feel free to contact me if you are interested in any of the projects, if you have any questions, or if you would like to get in touch with the center overall as well. We are organizing a national center, a national center's organized international conference on artificial intelligence, which will be in the coming April, inshallah. We hope that by that time, the pandemic will have ended and we'll be able to do that conference physically. So again, it's a pleasure to meet everyone. Please also visit me on my Facebook page and feel free to message me or something. I'd like to get in touch with you. Thank you very much.